Good morning, students. Professor, we have completed the portion. Also, the topics which were deleted from by CBSE, that also we have discussed, because for the competitive exams it will be there. Okay, today let's do the revision of this chapter, magnetic effects of current. Okay, starting with, we have discussed that what is magnetic field. Magnetic field is the region of the space around the magnet or near a current carrying wire in which its magnetic effect can be experienced. Okay, so this region of space we call it as magnetic field. Then magnetic field lines. Some imaginary lines could be drawn in this magnetic field which gives the direction of the magnetic field. These imaginary lines we call it as magnetic field lines. Okay, now there are some properties of these magnetic field lines. The first is that the magnetic field is a vector property, that is, it has got magnitude as well as direction. So the direction of the magnetic field, like for a bar magnet, it will be from north to the south pole outside the magnet. Whereas inside, it is from south to north pole. So outside the magnet, it is from north to south, and whenever we draw the magnetic field lines for a bar magnet, we have to draw the arrows on it, which gives the direction of the magnetic field lines. Okay. The second property is that where the magnetic field lines are crowded, there the magnetic field is very strong as compared to the place where the magnetic field lines are far apart from each other. So the closeness or the crowdedness of the magnetic field lines gives the strength of the magnetic field. More close to each other or more crowded, they are the magnetic field will be very strong. Like in case of a bar magnet, near the poles, the magnetic field lines are crowded. They are very, very close to each other. So the magnetic field is strong at the poles as compared to at the center. At the center of the magnet, the magnetic field lines are quite far apart from each other. So there the magnetic field is very, very weak. So at the poles, as the magnetic field lines are crowded, so the magnetic field is very strong at the poles. Next property we have studied that no two magnetic field lines can ever intersect. That is, two magnetic field lines can never intersect because the magnetic field has only one direction at a point in the magnetic field. So, as the magnetic field is having only one direction at a particular point, so two lines of forces, two magnetic field lines can never intersect. If they intersect, then at the point of intersection, there will be two directions of the magnetic field at the same point, which is not at all possible. Because the tangent to the magnetic field line gives the direction of the magnetic field. Now at the point of intersection, if you draw the tangents, two tangents you can draw. So it means two directions of the magnetic field at the same point, which is not at all possible. So two magnetic field lines can never intersect each other. Okay, so these were some of the properties of the magnetic field lines which we have studied. Then the magnetic field due to a long straight current carrying wire. Okay, due to a long straight current carrying wire, the magnetic field lines are concentric circles. Okay, with the wire at the center, you can draw concentric circles, and these are giving the magnetic field lines for a long straight current carrying wire. Okay, and the magnetic field due to a long straight current carrying wire, it is depending upon the current through the wire. How it is depending? Directly proportional to the current. More the current in the wire, more stronger will be the magnetic field. Okay, which you can take by the compass needle. Okay, so more the current, more will be the strength of the magnetic field. And the second is the distance from the wire. The magnetic field is inversely proportional to the distance from the wire. That is, as we move away from the wire, as the distance from the wire is increased, the magnetic field decreases. So the magnetic field is inversely proportional to the distance from the wire. So these are the two factors on which the magnetic field due to a long straight current line wire depends. The first one is current, more the current, more will be the strength of the magnetic field. And the second is the distance from the wire, more the distance from the wire, less will be the strength of the magnetic field. Okay, then the direction of this magnetic field, as we said, these are concentric circles. Like you can find out by sprinkling some fine fillings on the dartboard. Okay, through which this current carrying wire is passing, and gently tap it, you will see that there are distances in concentric circles. Okay, now here we have to draw the arrow on these magnetic field lines. So the guide and thumb rule, it gives the direction of the magnetic field to do a long straight current carrying wire. So in the right hand, if the thumb is pointing along the direction of the current, then the tips of the curled fingers, the tips of the wrapped fingers around it will give the direction of the magnetic field lines. So this thumb is giving the direction of the current. Then these tips of the curled fingers around it will give the direction of the magnetic field lines. Then at a particular point, if you have to find out the direction of the magnetic field, you will draw the field at that point. So at any point if you have to draw the direction of the magnetic field, you will draw the tangent at that tangent to the magnetic field line at that particular point. Okay, so the direction of the magnetic field due to a long straight current carrying wire is given by right-hand thumb rule. Okay, then after that we have studied the pattern of the magnetic field lines due to a circular current carrying coil. Okay, so a wire is in the form of a circle through which the current is passing. Okay, so here we see that the magnetic field is depending, first of all, on what factors it is depending. It is depending upon the current. More the current, more will be the strength of the magnetic field. Okay, also, it is depending upon the number of turns. Okay, if only one turn, there will be some magnetic field at the center. If there are two turns, the magnetic field due to both the turns will be added up. So greater the number of turns in the circular coil, more will be the strength of the magnetic field. So it is depending upon the number of turns of the coil. Okay, so these are the two factors on which the magnetic field depends. The first one is the current through the circular coil, more the current, more will be the strength of the magnetic field, it is directly proportional. And the second one is the number of turns of the coil, more the number of turns of the coil, more will be the strength of the magnetic field, that is, it is directly proportional to the number of turns. Okay, then the direction at the center of the circular coil, you can find out considering two diametrically opposite edges, draw the magnetic field lines due to the current carrying wire. Okay, and at the center you will see that the arcs of these circles becomes larger and it appears as if the lines are parallel to each other. So if the current is flowing in the clockwise direction, then the magnetic field, okay, so this is the clockwise direction. If the current is in the clockwise direction, the magnetic field will be perpendicular to us. And if the current is in the anti-clockwise direction, then the magnetic field will be perpendicular to that view outward. Okay, after that, we have discussed the magnetic field due to a solenoid. Solenoid is a wire which is wrapped on a cylinder. That is, it is in the form of a cylinder and the current is passed through it. That is called as a current carrying solenoid. Okay, having a large number of turns. Okay, now here, this solenoid is behaving like a bar magnet because the magnetic field lines, the pattern of the magnetic field lines are similar to that of a bar magnet. Okay, so the magnetic field is same as that of a bar magnet. Like in a bar magnet, one end is the north pole, the other end is the south pole. So here also, in case of a current carrying solenoid, one end of the solenoid behaves like a north pole, and the other end of the solenoid behaves like the south. And how do we find out that which one is the north and which one is the south? Looking from one of the pits, if the current is in the anti-clockwise direction, that face will become the north pole. Obviously, looking from the other face, the current will be in the clockwise direction, and that face will act like the south pole. So it is same like the bar magnet. So the magnetic field lines are from north to south pole, outside the solenoid and inside the solenoid, they are called south to north. Okay, and also you can check that which one is the north, which one is the south. Okay, when you bring a compass needle close to one end of the solenoid, if the south pole is attracted towards that end, then the south pole is pointing, south pole of the compass needle is pointing towards that end, it means that end of the solenoid is north pole. Okay, so this way you can also find out the north and south pole, or by the direction of the current also, you can find out that which place is acting like the north or south. So the magnetic field lines outside the solenoid are from north to south, and inside they are from south to north. Okay, also the magnetic field due to a current carrying solenoid depends upon the first factor, the current through the solenoid. More the current through the solenoid, more will the magnetic field inside the solenoid. Okay, here we are discussing inside the solenoid. So inside the solenoid, the magnetic field is depending upon the current. Magnetic field is directly proportional to the current through the solenoid. More the current, more will be the magnetic field inside the solenoid. The second factor is the number of turns of the coil. More the number of turns, more will be the magnetic field. Why? Because the magnetic field due to one turn will be added to the magnetic field due to the second, due to the third, and so on. So the magnetic field gets added up. So the magnetic field is directly proportional to the number of turns in the coil. More the number of turns, more will be the strength of the magnetic field. Okay, so directly proportional to number of turns. Also, it is inversely proportional to the length of the conductor. More the length of the conductor, okay, less will be the magnetic field. Okay, the formula is B is directly proportional to number of turns, directly proportional to the current, and inversely proportional to the length of the conductor. Okay, so these are the factors on which the magnetic field due to a current carrying solenoid depends. Okay, the magnetic field inside the current carrying solenoid. Okay, then what is the difference between the magnetic field pattern for a current carrying solenoid and for a bar magnet? They are similar. Okay, but inside the solenoid, the magnetic field can be varied. The magnetic field can be changed by changing the current, by increasing the number of turns. Okay, by increasing the current, the magnetic field that is inside the current carrying solenoid can be increased. Whereas in case of a bar magnet, inside a bar magnet, the magnetic field cannot be changed. Okay, only inside the current carrying solenoid, by changing current or by changing number of turns, the magnetic field can be varied. Okay, also the polarities of a current carrying solenoid can be varied. That is, the ion which is acting like a north pole can be made as a south pole power by reversing the direction of the current. By reversing the direction of the current, the direction of the magnetic field lines can be reversed. Whereas that is not possible in case of a bar magnet. Okay, so these are some differences between the pattern of the magnetic field lines for a bar magnet and for a current carrying solenoid. Okay, inside a current carrying solenoid. Okay, then we have discussed that a current carrying conductor, when it is placed in a magnetic field, it experiences a force. Any current carrying conductor which is placed in a magnetic field, it experiences a force, and this force is directly proportional to the current flowing through it, okay, and is directly proportional to the length of the conductor, okay, and that is B is proportional to the current and is proportional to the length of the conductor. Okay, that is the force experienced on a current carrying conductor when it is placed in a magnetic field. This force is directly proportional to the current, is directly proportional to the magnetic field. Okay, yes, now this will be maximum. This will be maximum when the current carrying wire is perpendicular to the magnetic field. We have already discussed the course on our Veda Health Open Activity. The course on our Kanaka is depending upon the Kare, is depending upon the length of the Kanaka, and is depending upon the magnetic field. So this course is directly proportional to the current as well directly proportional to the length of the Kanaka and also directly proportional to the magnetic field. Okay, and it is also directly proportional to sin theta, where theta is the angle between current carrying conductor and the magnetic field. Okay, in whichever direction the current is going and the magnetic field. And this sin theta will be maximum. We know that the maximum value of sin theta is 1. So when theta is equal to 90 degrees, that is the current carrying conductor is perpendicular to the magnetic field, then the force experienced by this current carrying conductor will be maximum. Okay, so this is the force experienced by a current carrying conductor when it is placed in a magnetic field. Okay, now the direction of this force is given by Fleming's left hand rule, which states that if we stretch the thumb, the forefinger and the middle finger of the left hand, okay, of the left hand, this is Fleming's left hand rule. So we are using the left hand. So if we stretch these three fingers mutually perpendicular to each other, such that the forefinger is pointing along the magnetic field, the middle finger is pointing along the direction of the current, then the force experienced will be given by the thumb. Okay, so this is the Fleming's left hand rule. So here you can see that this current carrying conductor is perpendicular to the magnetic field. As you can see, the middle finger is pointing along the direction of the current. The forefinger is pointing along the direction of the magnetic field. These two are perpendicular. So the force will be maximum. Okay, and it will be perpendicular to these two. Okay, so this is Fleming's left hand rule, which gives the direction of the force. Okay. After that, we have studied electromagnetic induction. Electromagnetic induction means whenever a magnet is moved in or out of a coil, some potential difference is developed across the ends of the coil. This potential difference, we call it as the induced potential difference. And whenever there is a potential difference, a current is produced in it. So the current is produced in the coil, which we call it as the induced current. Okay, and this phenomenon we call it as electromagnetic induction. So what is happening? There is some change in the magnetic field lines. So whenever there is a change in the magnetic field lines or the change in magnetic flux linked with the coil, then the current is produced in it. Such a current is called as the induced current, and this phenomenon is called as electromagnetic induction. So electromagnetic induction means whenever there is a change in magnetic flux with a coil, then some current is produced called as the induced current, and this phenomenon we call it as electromagnetic induction. Magnetic flux is the magnetic field lines crossing a given area. The number of magnetic field lines crossing a given area, we call it as the magnetic flux. So the number of magnetic field lines through an area changes, current will be produced. Okay, and how can you check that the current is produced? There is a device called as a galvanometer, which detects the presence of current in the coil. So you can connect the ends of the coil to the galvanometer. Okay, when you move the north pole of the magnet inwards, the galvanometer will show a momentary deflection along one direction. Okay, if you move the north pole of the magnet outwards, then the galvanometer will show a deflection in the opposite direction, indicating that the induced current is produced in the reverse direction. Okay, but if the coil and the magnet both are stationary, okay, that is, there is no relative motion between the coil and the magnet, no deflection is shown in the galvanometer, it means no induced current is produced. Okay, it is only due to the relative motion between the coil and the magnet. That is, you can keep the magnet stationary and move the coil inside the magnet or out. okay, or the magnet can be moved inside or out. That is, there should be some related motion between the magnet and the coil. Then only the induced current is produced. This is one of the method to produce the induced current. The second method is to change the current in one of the coil. Then in the neighboring coil, the induced current will be produced. So on a cylindrical rope, two coils are wounded. One of the coil having a large number of turns, which is connected to a battery and a key. The other coil connected to a galvanometer. When the key is just inserted, the galvanometer in the other coil, in the neighboring coil, will show a momentary deflection. Okay, why? Because the magnetic field lines to that coil is changing. Okay, as the magnetic field lines are changing, that is, the magnetic flux is changing. So some induced current will be produced in the second coil. Okay, the first coil we call it as the primary coil. The second coil we call it as the secondary coil. Okay. Also, when we just release the key, then when we take out the key, then also the galvanometer in the neighboring coil will show a momentary deflection, but in the reverse direction. That is indicating that the direction of the current has been reversed. Okay, but if the key is kept on pressed, if the key is inserted for a long time, then no deflection in the galvanometer of the neighboring coil. Why? Because now the current becomes steady and there is no induced current produced. Okay, so the current should change in one of the coils. The current should change in the primary coil. Then only the induced current will be produced in the secondary coil. Okay, and how the current can be changed? Just inserting the key or just taking out the key. Then in that case, the galvanometer in the second coil will show a momentary deflection. Now the direction of the induced current is given by Fleming's right hand rule. Okay, which states that, again, we stretch the thumb, the forefinger and the middle finger of right hand mutually perpendicular to each other, such that the forefinger is pointing along the direction of the magnetic field. The thumb is pointing along the motion of the conductor. Now the conductor is moving in this magnetic field. Then the induced current will be produced, or the current which is produced will be given by the center finger. Okay, so the direction of the current will be given by the center finger. So this is the magnetic field. This is the motion of the conductor. Then the center finger will give the direction of the induced current. This is the Fleming's right hand rule, which gives the direction of the induced current. Fleming's left hand rule gives the direction of the force on a current carrying conductor which is placed in a magnetic field. Fleming's right hand rule gives the direction of the induced current whenever there is a motion of a conductor in the magnetic field. Okay. Then also we have studied about electric motor, which converts electrical energy to mechanical energy. Okay, it is based on the same principle that whenever a current carrying wire is placed in a magnetic field, it experiences a force. So here the two opposite parallel, it is in the form of a rectangular coil. Okay, the wire is in the form of a rectangular shape. Okay, so the two opposite parallel arms will experience a force in the opposite direction, which will rotate this coil, okay, rotate this rectangular coil, and hence the electrical energy gets converted into mechanical energy. So we have studied in detail about its construction, working, okay, and the basic principle of it. Electric motor is used in many electrical appliances like electric fan, okay, in the washing machine, in the mixer. In many of the appliances, the electric motor is used. Okay, electric generator, which is deleted for this particular year, for this CBSE board exam, that is electric generator, which converts mechanical energy to electrical energy. That also we have studied in brief. Okay, so today we have done the revision of this chapter. Okay, and also the comments are open. You can write your name so that the attendance can be marked.